first. Today's session will be recorded. If you have any audio or video problems, or if you want to rewatch the session, no worries. As always, all recordings and registrations are available on rlpnetwork.com under the training tab. During the webinar, if you have a question for Cory, please use the Q&A function. The Q&A icon is at the bottom of your desktop screen or in the three-dot menu at the bottom right of your mobile device. Please note, Q&A is the only source we take questions from. Next to the Q&A icon, you will see the chat icon. Please use the chat feature to share any comments or observations with your colleagues, and be sure that your chat response is set to all attendees, so we will all see what you have to share. So let's try that now. Use the chat and share where you are joining us from. Ottawa, wonderful, Thunder Bay. What else do we have? More Ottawa, Vancouver, Coquitlam. Hey, go figure. Wasaga Beach, Toronto, Edmonton, Burlington. Great, as always, cross-country engagement is wonderful to see. Welcome everybody, wonderful to have you here. Thank you for attending today. It is my pleasure to introduce you to our guest, Cory Permack. Cory is the Director of Marketing and Business Development with Chairman's Club team, Permack and Associates, Royal LePage West Real Estate Services in Coquitlam, BC. Cory's over 18 years of experience in media, online, and digital marketing in the television and video game industries have helped to shape and hone his skill set and expertly serve the Permack and Associates team for the past 5 years. Cory's experience uniquely positions him to help you upgrade your video production skills to deliver better, smarter marketing and video production. It's an always popular subject, and of course, now more than ever, during the pandemic. We are delighted to have Cory here to share his insights on tools and tactics that will help you level up your video production. So welcome, Cory. Thank you for joining us.
Hi, thank you. I'm glad to be here. This is a topic I love talking about. I love sharing my experience and my expertise. So I hope that everyone watching here takes something away from this and learns something and is able to implement it in their own business to, you know, level up your business and you know, take your video production to another level. So should I just jump right in here?
Ready to go. I'm going to turn my camera off and turn it over to you.
All right, great. So I'll just start here from the top. As Kelly said, I'm a marketing director in business development with Permack and Associates. We're a team of four licensed realtors, plus me and two other admins. We're based in Coquitlam, BC, which is about 30 minutes east of Vancouver. Little background about me, just so you know where I come from. I'm a graduate of the University of Western Ontario in Western Literature and Civilization. I then went on to study at Ryerson in Toronto, where I learned radio and television arts, and then started a career in the television broadcast industry, which I did for about 10 years. I worked at CTV, I worked at Global, and I did all kinds of different things there, from the technical side, running the cameras, running the audio, to directing, to producing, pretty wide range of experience in the television broadcast industry. I had a stint for about 3 years in between my time in the television industry, working at Electronic Arts in the motion capture department here in Burnaby, BC. That was probably one of the coolest and most interesting jobs I've had. I had some really interesting experiences doing that. Throughout my whole career, I've always been an amateur photographer. I've always been interested in cameras and graphics and, you know, creating visuals. I started doing photography professionally in 2012 when I was laid off from my job at EA. And then that kind of morphed into working with Rebecca Permack. Some of you may know her. She is my wife, and we run the Permack and Associates team together. I started helping her with her photography and her video production or graphic design business or real estate business, doing the graphic design. And then in around 2015, I left all my other work and started helping Rebecca full-time in 2015, and our business really took off. And about 2 years ago, we started Permack and Associates and grew our team to what it is now. So right now I'm I do all the marketing with our team, and I work exclusively with our team. I don't do any, you know, outside work for any other realtors or any other teams. I do all of our photos, videos, 3D tours, graphic design, website management. I work on all of our back-end systems. I manage our CRM. I do all of our advertising, lead generation, and stuff like that. So my job description is huge. I'm not going to talk about all of that today. Today we're going to focus on video production. Now, that picture is not me, but I feel like there might be some people watching here who still shoot video with a camera like that. Today, hopefully, you're going to come out of this presentation inspired to upgrade your video equipment. So here's sort of an outline of what I'm going to cover. We're going to first talk about why video matters, why it's so important for you to be using video and incorporating it into your marketing. I'm going to talk about what gear I use and why I use it. I'm going to talk about camera settings a little bit, and it's going to be a little bit nerdy, and for some of you, it might feel like I'm speaking a different language. And I'm not going to dive too deep into it because this isn't the right forum for it, but I just want to give you a sense of, like, you know, what I do to capture the video that I do, just sort of gloss over it, and I'll show you how it looks. I'm going to talk about how you can maximize your time on location. We're going to talk about how to shoot cinematic video, how to create really great shots to use in your video production. We're going to cover editing. I'm not going to teach you how to edit, but I am going to give you some secrets and some, you know, perspective on things you can do with editing that can really take your video production to another level. We're going to cover getting all of this video that you're capturing and creating onto social media and the right way to do it. We'll touch on virtual tours. I think probably many of you are using virtual tours more than you ever have. I know we are. With, you know, showing in-person showings limited and, you know, trying to sell virtually. I'm going to give you cool ideas for how to upgrade your virtual tours using video. And then I'm going to finish off and give you some interesting tips and some apps and some interesting things you can use to shoot video on the fly. So this won't be like your high-end, you know, 4K, beautiful cinematic productions, but, you know, that's not always possible. So I'm going to give you some ideas for what you can do and gear that you can use to shoot on the fly and produce quick, effective videos. Things I'm not going to be covering today: cheap, quick, and easy ways to produce high-end video. Those things don't coincide. Producing high-end video takes work, takes effort, takes some skills, takes some knowledge, and it takes time. So I'm not going to be talking about cheap, quick, and easy because that doesn't exist for high-end video. I'm also not going to be talking about some out-of-the-box creative content ideas. There are many people, probably many of you watching, who are like incredibly creative and produce some hilarious, funny, interesting, great videos. I'm not here to talk about content ideas. So many of you are really good at that already. What I'm going to be talking about is how to create better quality videos with what you're already doing. Okay, so let's jump into this. Why video matters. You can spend hours down the rabbit hole of stats trying to learn and figure out why video is important. You can search in Google, you'll find an endless list. So I just pulled some relevant points that I found interesting. This is by no means an exhaustive list of stats, but important for what we're talking about today and why you should be using video. So viewers retain 95% of a message when they watch it in a video compared to 10% when reading it in text. That's pretty self-explanatory. Video is more effective at communicating your message than writing it. Social media posts with video have 48% more views. That means that when you're posting videos on social media, you're gonna have way more people engaging, way more people watching than you do with pictures or text. 62% of people said they're more interested in a product after seeing it in a Facebook story. So if you're marketing a property or even marketing yourself or your team, Facebook or even Instagram stories are an effective way to get people to learn about you and raise their interest level in who you are and what you're about. Social video gets shared 1,200% more than text and images combined. So that's self-explanatory. Your stuff is going to get more engagement if it's video form. Mobile video consumption rises by 100% every year. So we're exponentially increasing how much video we're producing, and people are exponentially increasing how much video they're consuming. And it is just getting bigger. And by 2022, online videos will make up more than 82% of all consumer internet traffic, 15 times higher than it was in 2017. So, you know, I don't think I need to like explain further. You get the idea. Video is exploding. Video is important. Video is the way that people are communicating. It's important that we do it well. So real estate video comes in many forms. Walkthrough, showcase, explainers, behind the scenes videos, testimonials, announcements, interviews, live streams, video blogs, tutorials, and many more. Today, we're going to be mostly focusing on property walkthroughs, property showcases, and a little bit of explainers and behind the scene videos. And I'm going to show you some examples of all of those things and some of the ideas that you can take and maybe do yourself. So let's get into this. Gear and tools. Some of you are going to see the prices at the bottom here and think like, oh my God, I am not spending that kind of money on video production. And that's fair enough. I realize that this is high-end stuff, but I want to talk to you about high-end video production. This is the gear that I use. I didn't always use this gear. This is the sort of an evolution of how I've shot video over the years. Starting out with the most important piece of equipment is your camera. So I use a Sony A7 R3. The reason I chose that camera, and I actually changed over from shooting Canon for many years, is that it's a mirrorless camera, so it's a little bit smaller, it's a little bit lighter weight, but it shoots excellent video in addition to shooting excellent photos. But the video quality that this camera shoots is excellent. And I pair that with my Canon 16-24mm lens. So that's a wide angle lens that is also, as you can see, quite expensive, but worth the investment. It's a great quality camera or a great quality lens. And the reason I'm using a camera lens with Sony is, like I mentioned, I used to shoot with exclusively Canon cameras. And I didn't want to go out and buy all new lenses. So they have what's called a lens adapter, and you can see it's called, the company's called Metabones, and they make adapters for all kinds of cameras. It allows me to use my lens, my Canon lens, on a Sony camera. It's not an absolutely perfect solution. Autofocus and some other functionality of the lens is a little bit reduced, but for what I'm doing and for the type of photography I'm doing and video I'm taking, it works fine because I'm primarily using manual focus and using all the manual functions of the camera. So it works. I do think I will upgrade to a Sony native lens at some point, but this is what I use now. Then to capture all of that smooth, beautiful cinematic video, I use a gimbal. And if you don't know what a gimbal is, it's a device that looks like that. You hold it and it stabilizes your camera no matter which kind of movement you make, up, down, side to side, tilting forward and backward. It keeps the camera nice and steady. So you can walk, you can move, and the resulting product is a nice, smooth video. They're not cheap either. The one I use is the Ronin M by DJI. It is now discontinued, actually. They have a newer product called the Ronin S, which is about $1,000. But it's essential for taking smooth cinematic video. To edit all the video and process everything, I use Final Cut Pro. It's an Apple product. It is a professional level editing software, but it's not limited to professionals. It is actually quite user-friendly. If you've ever used iMovie, it is sort of iMovie Plus. It's like iMovie, but with bigger, better features, which if you're shooting high quality video, you're going to want to have. iMovie is great. You can cut, you can paste, you can move things around, you can put a video together, but to really dive into the finer settings, the color control, things like that, you're going to want to upgrade to your Final Cut Pro. a lot of people use Adobe Premiere, which is another professional level editing software, and that's fine too. I'm more familiar with Final Cut Pro. That's what I use. And then lastly, a couple of smaller pieces, this DJI Osmo Mobile 3. I know some of you probably already have something like this. It's like a handheld gimbal. They're very inexpensive. They work with your phone. They're extremely effective for taking really great on-the-fly video, smooth production, and they're sort of an essential must-have now for shooting video out in the field when you're doing a quick thing. Maybe you're doing a selfie, maybe you're doing a virtual open house. It's great. Wireless mic is critical for doing any kind of speaking on camera. When you're contending with an on-camera mic, you've got wind, you've got exterior noise, you've got other things that make it very hard to edit in post-production. So having a wireless mic is critical. They're pretty easy to operate. They're not that expensive. Don't get a wired microphone because you're tethered to the camera and it limits what you can do. And then lastly, no lights. I do not use any lighting for my video ever. It's too cumbersome, it's hard to carry, it's hard to set up. You're gonna spend so much time on site worrying about your lighting. I don't do it, it's too much work. It's much easier to shoot without it, even though, you know, talk to 10 different people, half of them will say use lights, half of them will say don't. I personally don't, and I think the results are great. Okay, let us speak briefly about camera settings. This might be a little too techy, a little too nerdy for some of you, but I think some of you might be interested in this. and there's all kinds of debate on the best settings to use. Here's what I use. I always shoot in manual mode. If you put anything on auto, you're at the mercy of how the camera is reacting to the scene you're shooting, and you get inconsistent and unexpected results. So shooting in manual locks everything in. You know exactly what you're getting. I shoot 4K, which is, for, you know, consumer level cameras, about as high resolution as you're going to get. And I would argue that it's probably as high a resolution as you need. Some would say it's too much, too high a resolution. That's up for debate, but that's what I shoot in. I shoot at 30 frames per second. again, this is a personal preference. I'm also limited by the frame rate of my camera, which only does 4K at 30 frames per second. My shutter speed is 1/60th of a second, and the rule of thumb is 2 times the frame rate. So if my frame rate was 60, I would shoot at 1/120th of a second, or 1/125th. Aperture indoors is 4-8, outdoors is 9-12, just depending on the brightness. My ISO is between 8 and 3200, and then 1 to 320 outdoors, again, depending on the brightness. The only thing I put on auto is white balance, because I don't have time to run around finding something that's white in every single room of every single home to try and get the proper white balance. I think my camera does a pretty good job of deciding what the white balance is, and I can make adjustments to it in post-production, and it's generally not too far off. I'm always shooting in manual focus. My lens is always as wide as it can be. And this is for the real deep divers here. The picture profile I use is called Rec 709. And I'm not gonna explain it too deeply, but you can think of if you've ever heard somebody talk about the difference between shooting photos in JPEG versus shooting in RAW, it's kind of the same idea. Rec 709 is like a RAW video format, and it records much more information, so that later I can manipulate the picture a little bit better, change the colors, adjust the brightness. And it produces some really great video. So I'm gonna play this video of a property showcase that we just listed, actually. I captured it using all the equipment, all the settings that I've outlined, and here's what it looks like. Thank you. Okay, so that's just an example. That's an interesting look around the house. It's quick, it's short, it highlights everything. I almost think of it like a music video. Make my screen full screen again. Sorry. Oh, it's okay. So that's sort of an example of what kind of video I'm capturing using this equipment, these settings. Okay, maximizing our time on location. So this is important.
Cory, sorry to interrupt. Yeah. We just had some questions come through on whether this was, you know, it seemed a bit jumpy. Was that, were these a series of stills or was the video itself just jumpy? Like it was kind of jumpy between, it might've
been. No, it wasn't. The video itself is not jumpy. I feel like maybe the internet connection is not streaming it that cleanly. Those are all videos, all moving shots. So if it came across jumpy, we're, I think, going to be sending out a link or a document with all the links to all these videos after this is done or tomorrow. You can go back and watch all these again.
Great. Yeah. And we'll make that available on RLP Network where we host the recording. So we'll just add a link with this presentation so people can go back and play those videos anytime.
Okay. Yeah, I know. We're sort of at the mercy of our internet streaming here. So I apologize if it's not coming through exactly perfectly.
Okay, thanks.
All right, so maximizing time on location. This is really important to not just for your own sanity and well-being, for your clients too. They don't want you spending hours upon hours in their house trying to capture video. So it's important that we're being efficient, we're capturing the right things. Just let me point out, some of you may notice that the clock in the background of this slide is backwards. And that is just me not going out and finding a proper stock photo and finding one that works in a mirrored state. So I encourage you not to do that when you're doing your presentation. Anyways, on site, only shoot what you need and you don't need to shoot everything. So this is something I have just learned over time to be confident in the things I am shooting and don't go shooting crazy. Like you don't have to shoot like inside the, behind the curtains of every shower. You don't have to shoot inside the the unused dark bathroom in the basement. Like only shoot the things that you are going to use in the video. And knowing what's going to go into the video comes with experience, comes with time, comes with knowing how certain shots work in editing. But as you get better at it, as you have more experience, you're going to know what's going to work and what's not. Don't go crazy. Don't shoot everything. And know what your go-to shots are. So how do I shoot a big open living room space? I know exactly how to shoot that. How do I shoot a tight bathroom with mirrors that I'm going to see my reflection? Well, I know how to shoot that. So know your go-to shots. Repeat them. Everything you do can be formulaic, but not boring. Don't reshoot the same thing over and over. This is something I still struggle with. Sometimes I'll shoot a bedroom, for example. I'll walk in and I'll do a nice shot and then I'll think, I could have done that smoother. And I'll go back and I'll do it again. I'll be like, I didn't like the angle of that one. And I'll go back and do it four times. And I can't tell you how many times I'll get back and upload all the footage and look at it. And when I'm editing, I'll just use the first shot that I took. So you got to kind of trust that your gear is working properly. It's making a smooth video. You don't have to redo everything over and over again. Be efficient, trust yourself. There's usually no time for experimenting on site. You don't need to be Steven Spielberg. You don't need to be dreaming up incredible, amazing stage shots. There's really usually no time for that. Shoot your go-to stuff. If there's any really interesting features about the house or about the location you're shooting, spend some time shooting that, but don't go crazy. You don't have to experiment. You have to try new things every single time you're out shooting. One of the things that's important to me when I'm out shooting video is to think about editing while I'm shooting. And by that, I mean, think about how the shot you're currently taking is going to fit within your edited video. Does it have a start and an end point? Or is it just one long sweeping shot that you're not going to be able to find a good cut on the beginning and a good cut on the end? So think about editing, think how the shots are going to fit together, piece it together like a puzzle in your head as you're shooting it. It's going to make your editing work a lot easier. Then we like to have our agents come out to our listings on shoot day and shoot a bunch of promos. So we shoot all of the promos we can think of all at once. We'll shoot like a welcome to this house. We'll introduce people to the, you know, to the features. We'll talk, we'll do a promo for open houses or virtual open houses. We'll highlight some of the features like the backyard, and we'll shoot them all at once. It might take about half an hour, but you're going to be able to build 5, 6, 7 or more marketing pieces with one time on site. And it's really effective because posting the same thing, the same video over and over again is not going to be effective. But if you can post a video and then a different version of the video and then maybe a highlight of the backyard and then maybe something else that you've all captured at the same time, then you've got weeks of marketing instead of one marketing piece. Shoot B-roll footage. And you may have heard the term B-roll. That's an old video term referring to sort of, you know, your alternate visuals that overlay on top of your main video. So B-roll is things like, and I'm not just talking about property showcases here. I'm talking about like, you know, feature pieces or behind the scenes stuff. You're gonna shoot close-ups of things. You're gonna shoot people doing stuff in the background. You're gonna shoot wide shots of neighborhoods. You're gonna shoot all the stuff that isn't the main focus of your video, because you're gonna use that footage in your editing to make your video more interesting. So understand what B-roll footage is and shoot it. And then important, don't over-review or delete from your camera while you're on location. So we're all guilty of it. We'll go out and shoot a bunch of stuff. We'll go to our camera and we'll start looking through it and be like, oh, I didn't like that one, delete. And you'll be like, oh, I didn't like that one, delete. I encourage you never to delete stuff on site. We all have memory cards that are big enough to hold enough stuff. You don't need to delete stuff on site, and you may regret it. You might even use something for B-roll that you didn't expect to have, but just keep that shot. I'll show you some examples later of B-roll that I used that at the time I probably would have deleted because it was out of focus. I didn't like it, but you know what? It worked really well edited into a piece that we did. So that video that I showed you before, as choppy as it was for some of you, I want to show you 6 marketing pieces that we made at one shoot. You're going to see 5 in this video, and we'll talk about the 6th one later on. But here's what 5 different videos edited from the same shoot can look like. All right, so that's one shoot, one time on location, 5 different marketing videos, and a 6th one that I will show everyone later on when we talk about virtual tours. Another option, I talked about doing walkthrough videos. I'm not gonna show this video right now because I wanna get through to the next stuff and I don't wanna go over time here. But in the document that you're gonna receive after this, there's a link to the couple of videos here. One is a what I call a walkthrough video. So the property showcase video is almost more like a music video where you're cutting from room to room and you're showing off the stuff. A walkthrough video is literally one long shot walking from the entrance of the home through the rooms, giving people basically a tour of the home. And then this other video over here is a neighborhood walk around that I did. And it's, again, while you're on site, while you're shooting, you can just go walk around the neighborhood, shoot a little time lapse of what's going on, give people a sense of what the neighborhood looks like. When they walk out their front door, what are they going to see? So just other examples of capturing more content while you're on site than just the primary content that you're there to get. Okay, cinematic magic. So what makes videos interesting and good? Personally, it's cinematic shots. And by cinematic, I mean interesting or artistic. So it's very easy, and honestly, there's nothing wrong with it, but it's very easy to walk into a room and just stand in the corner and just go like this. And that is a style, there's nothing wrong with it, but I like to add a little bit more of a dynamic movement, a little bit more of a dynamic look and feel to it, try to make things cinematic. So here's some things that you can think of when you're thinking cinematic, when you're taking videos, how can you make them more interesting? So, I'm going to show you some examples of this in a second, but foreground objects in your shot add depth and dynamics. It helps give people some perspective on the space and makes it more interesting. It gives you two planes of focus. So foreground objects and revealing a room are almost kind of the same. So instead of just standing in a room, reveal the room, walk into the room, show it from around the corner. Let people feel like they're peeking around the corner and looking into it. Adds a little bit more intrigue, a little bit more interest. You can use high and low angles to give a different perspective. I like to use doorways as a sort of a threshold that you're walking into. You're using them to like change from one room to another. It's a nice transition. Always go slower than you think. Move slowly, take slow shots. Slow down your movements because it's going to give it a nice, slow, smooth feel when you go into editing. And then in editing, you're going to want to slow down and stabilize all your footage and give it that nice, slow, buttery, smooth shots. So here's some examples of what I mean by cinematic shots. So those are all shots that were from the video that you saw before, but those are like the unedited together shots, but they're cinematic, they're interesting, they show the room, they bring the viewer right into it. And this all leads us to editing. Editing really is where magic happens in video. If photography and videography is all about the eye, editing is all about feel. It's about taking the raw material that you have and piecing it together into a story. You're telling a story of the home, you're telling a story of an event, you're telling a story of something that's going on behind the scenes, about how your team is preparing for open houses, whatever it is. But you're taking all of those raw pieces, bringing them together. Even standard property showcase videos can be interesting, like the one I showed you. With editing, timing is everything. Timing it to music, timing the placement of your graphics, how your audio fades in and out is really the key to it. And it's, again, about feel, understanding the flow, understanding how to piece things together in a natural way that's interesting to watch. Personally, I like to keep things simple and elegant. I don't use a lot of effects. I don't use a lot of transitions. I don't use a lot of animations. I like to do hard cuts. I'll use a transition sometimes if I'm moving from like indoors to outdoors or from upstairs to downstairs, just to visually bring people to a different space. But generally, simple, elegant, and clean for me is a nice way to present these kind of videos. Color balancing, this is a tough one. This takes a little bit of experience, and I am not an expert at it. It is hard for me to get color balance proper. It is a real art form. Shooting, like I said, in that raw video format allows you a little bit of leeway with your color. So if your auto white balance isn't getting you the results, you do have some room to play and manipulate it. It's hard to do. Practice makes perfect. It can really make your videos look consistent. You can rescue a lot of bad footage, but it takes time. And so by that, I mean, try and get it all right on site while you're shooting it, so that you don't have to spend so much time later in editing, fixing everything. Use music, but make sure you mix it properly. There's some links here to some places where you can find free music to use with your videos. Some of them require you to attribute the artist, some of them don't. Again, these links are included in the document you'll be getting. Keep your videos moving, the viewer is already bored. So you might think you've got a 5-minute masterpiece on your hand, and it's like the greatest thing you've ever created, and it's beautiful, and you can watch it over and over. I promise you that people watching your videos on Facebook don't think the same thing. 5 seconds in, they're wondering what's interesting about this? What are you gonna show me? Tell me what I wanna see. I'm already bored. So keep your videos moving. I'm as big a victim of that as possible. I think everything I make is a masterpiece. And when people don't wanna watch the whole thing, it hurts. But don't dwell, don't make epic 3, 5, 8 minute long videos. Nobody's watching those. Use your branding in your editing every chance you get, but don't be obnoxious. You probably saw our little intro animation there with our logo. We got that done for about $50 at you may have all heard of a website called Fiverr. It's where you can hire people for pretty inexpensive amounts to create animations for you. It's an endless list of things you can hire people to do on a per project basis. You can get them to do voiceovers, they can write copy for you, they can do all kinds of stuff. Go check it out. But get your logo animated, use a little thing at the beginning and the end, brand yourself. And again, back to B-roll. Understand what B-roll is and shoot lots of it, because it will make your videos more interesting. So I'm gonna show you a couple things here that I think are really great examples of editing and B-roll, and look for that blurry shot that I mentioned before that I would have ordinarily deleted. Look for it and how I used it in these videos. And apologies to Rebecca. She is not thrilled that I'm using these videos. They're a few years old, but I think you're gonna appreciate the editing in here. So let me play them for you.
On this episode of Real Estate Revealed, we've got a huge community event coming up next week. So I'm going to take you guys behind the scenes on a little bit of prep work. So beyond just selling homes in the neighborhood, one of the things that we're super committed to here at Burke Mountain Homes is putting on great community events for our friends and neighbors in the area. And our next big event is the Burke Mountain Community Easter Egg Hunt happening on Good Friday, April the 14th. So today we're doing inventory at the storage locker to see what we've got. We've got Easter hats, Easter baskets, their signage, Easter cash boxes, all that fun stuff. So come on with me, we'll head over to the storage locker. Welcome to my storage locker. Here's where all the magic happens. We keep all our stuff for our staging, all of our community events, Easter, Halloween, all of our signage, all of our extra files. So we pulled our two bins for the Easter egg hunt, and we're going to do a quick inventory and see what we've got. We've got the 3 cash boxes for collecting all of your donations. Thank you.
to cut that one short, but in there was a couple of like really out of focus shots that most people would be like, that's a terrible shot, delete it. Worked really good in there. It gives you a feel for the scene, for what's going on. Interesting video. Here's another one. All right, I'm gonna stop that one short as well. You get the picture. A lot of B-roll, narrative, a story. We're moving through it. It's quick edits. Interesting. Okay. Now you've got all this great video. You've edited a great video. What do you do with it? Social media. You must be using social media. It's the best way to distribute your video. It's the best way to market what you do. It's the best way to tell people about your listings, about your business, about yourself. It's important though that you're not just throwing things out there indiscriminately. There are different limitations, different reasons to use each one. I'm not gonna go deep into why you should use one or another or what's better about them, but I just want you to understand why you should use them and what things you need to know before posting video on each one. I think it's important, a couple of things to point out are if you have people talking in your videos, use closed captioning. Many, if not most people, don't watch video with audio, especially if they're just scrolling through it on their phones. But if you have captions, they'll read them. You can create captions using Facebook and YouTube's built-in captioning tools. They're easy to do. I suggest you do them for all of your talking videos. And then for people to see your videos, unfortunately, we live in a world where you gotta pay to play. If you're just posting the things on your Facebook profile or Instagram feed or whatever, most people aren't seeing your videos. Facebook is not sharing them with all the people you like to see them. So you got to pay, you got to run ads, you got to boost your posts. Again, this isn't a webinar about how to do that, but learn about that. You got to boost it. If you want people to see your stuff, you got to pay. Different aspect ratios for different platforms. I always edit different versions of my videos for the different platforms, especially if I'm going to be doing Facebook or Instagram stories or IGTV, which is Instagram TV. I want a vertical video so it fits on your phone. That's how people are watching them. If you've got a small little horizontal video, not as effective. I edit for the platform that I'm going to be showing it on. So that's like I showed you before, I had five versions of the same video. One of them was a vertical aspect ratio to post on Facebook and Instagram stories. Okay, virtual tours. I realize that we're about 45 minutes in here, so I'm not gonna dwell on all this stuff for too long, but if you're not doing virtual tours, you should be, especially now with COVID-19. You know, things are kind of creeping back to normal. We're doing some in-person showings. People are a little bit more comfortable, but things have changed for us, and they're gonna be different for a long time, if not forever. You need to be doing virtual tours. You can hire people to do virtual tours for you. It's gonna cost you about $200 to $400 per virtual tour, depending on the size of the home. We decided to go and invest in a camera and do it ourselves. It's not cheap, but it's going to pay off for us in the long run. Now, you've seen your standard, you know, dollhouse view, your Matterport tours, all that stuff. But there's ways you can use video in those tours to enhance it and make it a little bit more interesting. You can shoot a welcome video. You can show off some of the cool features. You can look inside closets, storage, and mechanical rooms. And I want to show you an example of that. So this is the home that I just showed you, the same one we did the video showcase for. And this is our 3D Matterport tour, but you see these little yellow things, those are called matter tags, and they can highlight features of the home. And one thing I do is right where people are entering the home, I put a little video in that looks like this. Right? So you can do that all over the home. You can do that in the backyard. You can do it in the rec room or the amazing kitchen. You can have little explainer videos throughout. They're easy to do. They're quick to capture. And you capture them all at the same time along with your promo videos with the agent on site. And then, we are starting to do some more in-person showings now here in BC, but a few months ago, we weren't doing any in-person showings and we were on lockdown. And so I went around and I included videos, but of the washer and dryer, look inside the closet, give people a chance to see in things that they would normally do in person, but we were doing this all virtually. So I took little videos of the closets, of the things around the unit that they couldn't otherwise see, and included them in the 3D virtual tour. So those are just some ideas. They're endless. You could go on and come up with crazy, fun, interesting ideas to include in your virtual tours. I suggest you do it. Make yours stand out. More and more realtors are using virtual tours. Make yours different. Make them better. Tell your clients that that's what you're doing, and they'll probably hire you. Okay. Lastly, cool tools for producing video on the go. So I'm not talking high-end 4K, HD, beautiful cinematic video here. I'm talking on the fly, on the go, while you're on the train in a foreign country and you want to put a great video together about the weekend you just had with your friends, you can use these tools and do it quickly and for cheap. So the DJI Osmo Mobile 3, we already covered that. That's your portable gimbal for your phone. It shoots great, smooth video. It does some other great things like time lapse, and it has a great tool for actually like following you. You can set up on a tripod and move around and it will follow you. It's a great thing. It's cheap. You should all have one. DJI Mimo is an app that is paired with the Osmo Mobile 3. It allows you to use all of its functionality. There are a lot of great mobile video editing tools. Everyone's got their preference. There's a lot of great ones. The one I like to use is called Splice. It's simple. It gives me all the things I need to do. It's elegant and it's easy to use. And you can bring photos in from your camera roll and incorporate with video. Really simple. And then the other one I like to use is called Quick. It's actually GoPro's branded video editor. But don't let that put you off. You can use it without a GoPro. And the thing about this one that I really like is you can bring all kinds of videos, photos, everything into it and put it into a template, and it will spit out a beautiful, interesting video with sound and movement and all kinds of stuff. It's kind of a quick and dirty way to produce a really interesting video on the fly. One of the best things about it is that, live photos, if you take live photos on your phone, they're not just still, they're just like, a 3-second little video. It takes that little video and makes it into, or takes that live photo and makes it into a video. So I think it's cool. It makes some really great little quick little edits. You can produce some really fun stuff with it on the fly. Go download it, play around, it's fun to use. And that brings me to the end of my formal presentation. Again, these links that are here are gonna be included in the document you're gonna receive. You can go back and watch all these videos plus some that I didn't show, and they will be available for you to check out.
Thanks so much, Cory. That was great. I'm sorry that Zoom wasn't as cooperative as it could have been to see your great videos. But as I said in the chat, we'll post this presentation directly onto the Maintaining Momentum page on RLP Network. So you need only go there and download the presentation and see those videos as they were meant to be seen. We do have some questions for you, Cory. The first one is a great one. What was the video that you called where you go from the outside and you go right in and you do everything in one shot? What was that called?
I call it like a walkthrough video.
A walkthrough.
Yeah. It's like literally one shot. And I'm starting at the entrance of the home. And I'll show the kitchen, and I'll show the living room, and I'll walk into the office, and then I'll go into the bedroom, all in one continuous flow.
Right. And when you're doing that, how do you deal with the transition from an exterior exposure to an interior exposure? Because you have different lighting levels.
That's an excellent question. And I try to avoid it as much as possible, is the truth. There are ways to do it. You can put your camera on auto exposure or auto ISO. There are ways to do it. I did say that I only use manual mode, but you know, there's rules and then there's breaking the rules. And so sometimes you're forced with a situation where the lighting change from one room to another or from inside to outside is dramatic. And then you throw it onto auto ISO or auto exposure. And then you deal with that footage when you get home. But that's how I would do it. Yeah.
Okay. That's great. Heather Lemieux asks, thought it was really great what you did with your Matterport tours, that you could post those, you know, little video vignettes right into the tour experience. She's using iGuide. Do you know anything about iGuide and whether she can post those there as well?
I'm not familiar with iGuide, unfortunately. Our experience is only with Matterport.
It's coming to iGuide, apparently, according to Ainsley Tracy in the chat. So there is hope for you, Heather. It's coming. Yeah. It's coming.
And there are lots of tools besides Matterport to capture 3D spaces and stuff. This is what we use, right? I'm not saying it's better or worse. I'm just sharing my experience.
Right. And you talked about using a gimbal today. Robin Shee has asked, how do you make the video smooth when you're zooming in and out or moving horizontally and vertically? We assume the latter is with the gimbal, but I'm not sure about the zoom.
I never use the actual zoom feature on my camera. Like, I don't zoom the lens in ever. Any moving forward or moving back is me physically walking forward or physically walking back. And the gimbal really does help you keep it smooth. It is not an easy tool to use. I'm not going to pretend that anyone can just pick it up and just like la-di-da and go shoot beautiful video. It takes practice, takes some understanding of how to move properly. It is exhausting. It's heavy. You're holding it like this for a bit of time. And then using my editing tools, I will also apply stabilization, some smoothing to make it even smoother in the final product than it was when I captured it. So I hope that answers the question.
Great. Now you talked about you know, when you know someone's watching your video, they're already bored. So make it short. But, you know, do you have a specific recommendation? I think you said no longer, you know, you don't want to make it 5 to 8 minutes, but you know, there's some general consensus out there about making videos even shorter. And Laura Dickinson asked if it is best to keep the video under 2 minutes. What were your thoughts on that one?
I would say, my goal, I'm always aiming for 1 minute. That's where I like to cut it off. And the reason for that has to do as much as with like technical limitations and also what I think viewers are willing to watch. Instagram specifically only allows you to upload a 1 minute video to your feed. Anything beyond 1 minute, it will either cut it off or ask you to post it to IGTV, Instagram TV, which is fine. You can post to Instagram TV and utilize that part of Instagram, and we do, but I like that 1 minute music video style, easy to digest, easy to watch clip that I can put in my Instagram feed. So I'm bound by the limitations of Instagram for 1 minute videos, but I also think anything beyond 1 minute, unless it's an explainer, unless it's people talking, unless it's a story, unless it's a behind the scenes kind of thing, if I'm just showcasing a property, 1 minute is my goal. I really don't think people are sitting and watching and like watching every shot right through the end. I try to keep the most interesting stuff, the most relevant stuff in the first 20 to 30 seconds. If people are watching beyond that, that's a bonus. I don't expect that they're really watching.
Right. Now, is it when we talk about that video again, is it better to have a voiceover discussing the shot or a music track? And I noticed with Rebecca, and I don't know whether Rebecca's B-roll, I don't know whether it was the Zoom experience added on to that, but I heard her talking, but I also heard music in the background. So do you have a preference or a recommendation on which way to go, one or the other or both?
For most of our walkthrough videos, we don't have a voiceover at all. We'll just showcase the property with a music bed underneath it. You saw the version of Rebecca introducing the property and talking, and it may not have come through exactly perfectly, but there was music under it, dipped down lower level while she was talking. So their voice came through clearly. And you really have to be aware of that. You really have to mix your audio because you don't want the music to drown out what the person is saying. It's like I said, editing is an art form, and it's subtleties. It's being able to bring music, voice up and down as necessary. I wouldn't say I have a recommendation for whether you should always use a voiceover or whether you should always have somebody talking on camera. I think it's listing dependent, it's situation dependent. It's, you know, how much marketing effort are you going to put into this listing versus that listing? Sometimes your agent isn't available to come shoot that stuff. You know, it's sort of like case by case. I like it when we do it. I don't overuse it. So you saw that video with Rebecca talking. It was just a little bit at the beginning, a little bit at the end. We personally don't do the like walk through and talk about each room. Because again, I don't think anyone's watching those. I really don't. That's just my opinion. I don't have stats. I don't have a study on that, but that's how we produce videos. So.
Right. Maybe in a virtual open house situation, but yeah. Some more questions from Ron Harvey. You guys maybe need to connect. He's got a ton of questions to download all that great expertise you have. He was asking about focal lengths for indoors and outdoors. And do you mostly use, sorry, my screen is blocked. Do you mostly use a 20 millimeter or 24 millimeter focal length?
I shoot all my video exclusively at 16 millimeters. That's the same, it's a wide angle lens. It's the same lens I use for photography. And it's 16 millimeters and it's super wide. It captures the best stuff. It also makes focusing a little bit more forgiving. If you're zoomed in or if you're on a tighter focal length, your depth of field gets a little bit more narrow. Hopefully I'm speaking your language here, but shooting wide open allows you the most flexibility with framing, allows you the most flexibility with focus. If I need to crop something or make it tighter, I'll do that in post-production and I'll zoom the video in.
Okay. And what about indoors and outdoors? Does that make any difference for you?
No difference. I use the same lens, the same settings, indoors and outdoors. The only thing I adjust is my ISO and my aperture to adjust for the brightness of the different places.
We have a question in the chat. Once a property is sold, allowed to keep the video up, are you allowed to keep the video up on social media, and do you?
Yeah. Oh yeah, absolutely. We don't delete videos once they're sold. This is marketing me talking now, not video me, but I look at every listing we have as an opportunity to get more business. I'm using the materials, the videos, everything that we produce for our current listing to showcase what our team does to get more business. So we put everything on social media and we leave it on social media. One thing I'm careful not to do, you should consider, is don't put pricing in your social media posts, and don't put like, you know, sold or anything on it, because if they have a price attached to it or something, And then you have to lower your price, you have to change the price. Then you're scrolling back through your old posts and trying to adjust everything. So I try to keep them as generic as possible, talk about, one or two sentences about the specifics of the home, a link to the listing on our website. That's it. And that listing or that post lives on our social media forever. I'll never change it.
Do you need to get any permissions from the seller for that in advance or as far as you're aware? And maybe
I don't believe so. I mean, sellers generally agree to all of the marketing activities that we're doing. They're aware of all the videos that we're taking and where we're putting them. We're not revealing any personal information about the sellers or about, anything personal. So we've never asked permission to post it or keep it. And we've also never had anybody ask us to remove it.
I know I liked it when I bought my last house. The video was up forever. It's not around anymore, but actually, it was great to share.
I will take that back, actually. One time about 8 years ago, we did shoot a video for a house and somebody years later, I think the original owner of that house said, how come I can still see a video of my house and my stuff on your website? And we said, sorry, and we just took it down. That's the only time anyone's ever questioned it.
Right. Okay. We're getting near to our time. Actually, we're right there, but we'll take one more question. And I did see something in the chat. If you had a listing, let's say that was lower end, would you still shoot it? It's not, maybe it's tenanted and, the tenants haven't necessarily tidied up, or what would you do in those circumstances?
That's always a case-by-case basis. So mm-hmm. If we're talking about, I hate using the word lower end, but a lower price point kind of, one bedroom condo that hasn't been well looked after or something like that. Assuming that it's tidy and, we've been able to clean it up and whatever, absolutely. We don't change the level of marketing or video production that we do because of the price point on a listing. We do the same thing for every listing we have. We do sometimes face challenges when maybe we're doing a foreclosure property or a property that's been damaged or the owners don't want to clean up, or we've all had those kinds of listings. And we do sometimes decide not to shoot video or sometimes not to do a 3D Matterport tour just because it's not going to showcase the property well, or the owners aren't accommodating. There are for sure times where we don't shoot video or 3D tours, or sometimes we're limited with how many photos we can take if a tenant doesn't want to leave or whatever. So we always do the best we can, but ideally our top level is shoot everything, do the videos, do the production on every single listing we have.
That's great. Thank you, Cory, so much for your time and insight and knowledge today. We truly appreciate it. And as a reminder to everybody, we will post this recording as well as Cory's presentation with links to his videos on rlpnetwork.com under the training tab. Just look up Maintaining Momentum Webinars. Thanks so much for your time today, Cory. Much luck to you. Have a great late spring market. Take care.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Thanks.